So second part, more interactive. You see my screen, no problem?
Yes, that's okay.
Yes.
In full screen,
we'll
perfect.
Try to now use different tools in order to analyze and understand what in our spectra. And I took a complex example, but very d'actualité. Bonsoir, d'actualité. Je vois le cerveau.
Of the moment.
Yeah. First, four or three slides in order to have the comprehension of, in fact, the radiative processes in the spectra. First idea is a very important concept for the analysis of NOVA. It is a concept of opacity. So it's a very general concept. You have an intensity of the incoming flux, which depends of the wavelengths. And through a medium, for instance, a gas, or interstellar medium with dust and so on, the radiation can be absorbed or diffused. And finally, when the radiation arrives to the Earth, to the observer, we have a decline of the intensity of the radiation at certain wavelengths, and it is measured with what is called optical depth. One important fact is that the optical depth strongly depends on the wavelengths. For blue wavelengths, we have much more absorption than for red wavelengths. Second point, if you have a radiation emitted at certain wavelengths. Here it is not, 6582 angstroms, but 62 angstroms. You can have some radiative processes of excitation of the electrons, of the atoms. And this is especially the case for hydrogen H-alpha line, which have a very high probability to be absorbed by atoms of hydrogen. So if you have a radiation, a photon at 62 angstroms, the probability that it is absorbed by hydrogen is higher than a photon which is out of the range of absorption. Three points, of course, here I have shown a uniform absorption medium, but of course, we can have various intensities of the absorption, and the final optical depth will be the integral. We have to, sorry, I have integral, François.
I think integration.
Integration, yes, on all the absorption medium. Second idea is the concept of the, from this concept of opacity. Here, I have shown what can be the, this is a very simple model of the ejecta of a nova. At the maximum luminosity, we have the temperature of the photosphere, which is low, about 10,000 of kelvins, and the opacity is very strong. So, excuse me, the optical depth is very high. Here, I'm showing the photosphere and the ionization zone, which are very near the limit of the ejecta. Thus, due to the low temperature of the photosphere, we shall have only low ionized lines. This is the evolution of the ejecta. The ejecta, of course, expands. The photosphere recedes. And as a result of the perfect gas law, we have an increase of the temperature of the photosphere, and so on, and so on. As the ejecta expands, its density lowers. And we begin to see, this is the response of one of the questions, we can begin to see forbidden lines. In fact, it is more correctly to say collision electron, sorry, lines produced by the collisions of electrons, which can be observed only in media of very low density. As the photosphere continues to recede up to a temperature of more than 100 of thousands kelvins, very high ionized lines called nebular lines can be observed. 2 points. What is called photosphere in the ejecta of a nova is not exactly a photosphere. I would prefer to use a name of pseudo photosphere because the opacity can vary over a very large range from 1 to 100, depending on the wavelengths. Second point, and this is also an answer to one of the questions. Here is, the Gautrian diagram for I want to. There are very few yawns of I want ionized one time in the ejecta, but there are so many transitions that the very few number of I want ions ionized one time can absorb a very large part of the radiation emitted by the continuum. There are few, okay, but they can absorb a lot of light. This is the reason why this state of the development of the spectrum is called I1 curtain. Next point, it is very important to have in mind the different ionization levels. Here is a graph with the various ionization levels in units of electron volts for the various species. The lines, the blue lines, are the ionization level for hydrogen, the first ionization level for helium, the second ionization level for helium, so the lines of helium 2. Sorry. This is very important because if you have lines near, say, the maximum of luminosity of a nova with carbon, nitrogen, and so on, you cannot have at the state very high ionization lines. This is a second presentation of the ionization energy according with the most observed line in nova spectra, but of also other objects. And it is important also to have these values. Last point, from the observed lines, you have an order of magnitude of the temperature of the photosphere. If you observe, for instance, HE1 line, it's at about 24 electron volts, you have the order of magnitude of the temperature of the ionization source, 1000 the energy of ionization. For instance, so you see helium 2-1, you can say the temperature of the ionization source is about 25,000 Kelvin. Last point, the radial velocity. I think that everybody knows what it is from Doppler effect. Here's a figure. It is important to build, I think, such curves for each wavelength. Here is the wavelength of H alpha line according to the radial velocity from the west wavelengths of the line in order to tune the Guatting's angles, but also essentially for analysis of the line profiles. Now I go to the NOVA-PERSEI 2020. Here is the light curve from AVSO database and our spectra along the development of this NOVA with Echelle spectra obtained at a resolution of about 10,000. Very interesting work produced by Robin Leadbeater, Paolo Berardi, and Umberto Solecchia, upon the request of Steve Shaw, with very interesting results in the near IR range. And many spectra also of H-alpha lines produced essentially by Etienne Bertrand and Robin Leadbeater and so on. And we'll work on that material. Here is the first spectrum of the NOVA obtained by David Boyd just after the alert, yes, when the NOVA was, otherwise, it is a flux calibration, flux calibrated spectrum. And we see the spectrum, which is very flat, continuum. You see that it is not the spectrum observed in Nova Delphini 2013. We have not the blue continuum, but we have first thing very important to know, of course, it is the bulbar lines. So it's easy. The question now is what are the other features, lines, and so on? I propose to stop sharing the screen and I open the spectrum, I open the spectrum of David and first from the spectrum, I use essentially a plot spectra. You see the screen?
No, you have to share your screen, François.
Thank you very much. Please recall me because there's not.
But we can see your face, so it's great also. But
okay. Who is he? Sorry. Just a minute. Comment je fais? Voilà.
Je pense normalement tu peux partager tout ton écran en fait.
Oui,
c'est le premier, quel premier choix. Comme ça, quand tu changes des trucs à ton écran, on le voit tout de suite.
Ouais, ça. Ouais. Bah oui, sorry. Comment ça se fait ça? Bon, c'est la première fois que je vois. Merde, c'est du français. Hein.
Translated, but I guess that everybody okay. has understood.
Alors, excuse me. Very sorry. I will use all my windows. Share. Ah. Good.
Yes, we can see a plot spectra screen.
Thank you very much. Yeah. So we have said this is the first spectrum obtained by David Boyd with the Balmer lines. We can see that other lines are in emission. The first one voilà. Interesting. Can be identified as carbon 2. And in fact, I double click on it at this resolution of 1000, we can see in fact that the profile have two tops, and these are in fact two lines of carbon 2. What is very interesting, and this is the method for the analysis of a spectrum in order to identify the lines, is to check if other lines produced by carbon 2 appears in the spectrum. And in fact, the second line appears at 4267. So from the first identification of this strong emission line, you have a confirmation of the identification with this line. This is very important. The identification of lines in the spectrum cannot be the result of a lotto. If you open a very large list of lines, I take this one with more than 800 of lines in the spectrum of the symbiotic nova tell, it is always easy to put a line at the place you want in the spectrum, even if it is very improbable. At this state, for instance, you cannot have iron ionized three times. The identification of lines is the result of the study of similar objects first, but also of whole a mind exercise. Can this line at this level of excitation of ionization can be observed in the spectrum? Secondly, if I detect one line, can I detect the other lines? So thus, there's two identification makes the result stronger, more robust. Second, I see there something which is very interesting because I have in mind, of course, the wavelengths of helium 1. Helium 1 is not improbable at the state of the development of a nova. I see that the wavelength is about, in fact, yes, helium one. I open another list of identification, and we can see that I add it to my list. Yes, that's good. Is it sufficient to say that it is helium one? No, because you can have many ion lines at the state of the development of the nova. So I will see the other helium lines, and especially the triplet line that I add to my list. This is the triplet of helium one. This is singlet. It matches. I add another one very near to edge beta. I add it to my list. Yes. So you have a confirmation of the first identification. Can go on. Still on David Boyd's spectrum. Here is the version of helium one triplet. Here is we have the emission of helium one, and you see clearly two emissions. These are sodium lines. So here we can add the sodium lines. Good. And after we have also these lines. This one, I look at my list. Sorry. First, I begin to check the wavelengths. 5,687, 88. Do I find the line? No. It cannot be. I want ionized. So I have to open another list. And this one is really, really wonderful. This is, there are 800 lines about. This is a symbiotic nova our telescope. And I have to check if I see something at this wavelength. I come back, sorry. 5,687 chart settings. 5,687. Ah, it can be. No, sorry. 5,687. Sorry. 5,687 have no lines. So I have to open another list. I don't remember which one. So I will stop. Excuse me. This is sodium line, and this one is also a sodium line. Okay? Sorry for my list. So we have identified some very interesting lines. Another point is I1, 2, with notably the multiplet 42, which is in this zone, but we'll see that in more details with other spectra, notably produced by Christian at maximum luminosity.
So, by the way, François, just a, a small comment very quickly. It shows what you are showing here is it shows how it is important to have low resolution spectra. And I'm just saying that for people who think that high resolution is better than low resolution, really depends. And in this case, this is very important to have a wide range.
I do agree for several reasons. First is that high resolution spectra, especially with Eichel and so on, we shall have spectra only on white objects. Mm-hmm. And at a certain moment, especially with nova events, if the when the star will fade, it is very important to have low resolution spectra. Second point, I have not here the presentation, but many of our low resolution spectra have been used in professional publications. I will send you a list of professional publications using our resolution spectra. I consider that since the resolution is about 600, there is really information in the spectrum. Okay, and this is the reason why I begin the our database from 500 resolution. Yeah. Even if some guys have obtained with a simple star analyzer almost the same resolution than, for instance, an LP. But this is very high level of the usage of a star analyzer. Yeah. And also, it means that some colleagues using an LP have not the best resolution which can be obtained with an LP. I can show. Alors, où est-ce que j'en suis? Sorry. Come back. I will share the screen. I come back for a few slides and the presentation. What is important is use the you see my screen, I think.
Yes. Yeah? Yes.
The commented spectra in publications. And very good reference is Williams, who produced in 1980 and 1984, a large amount of data from a survey. And there were very, very very interesting publications. Here is, for instance, publication of a slow nova whose bell curve is about the same that the nova observed in autumn and winter 2020. And you have line identifications. You have also, of course, access to, the general list of land underneath. You have also the historical lights list of Merrill or more, which are very important. And you have some reference stars, and notably in Williams, an appendix of the lines observed in Novae. So you can download it from my website. What more? Comment je fais pour revenir en arrière? Sorry. Renova. Le mieux c'est que j'arrête. And I come back. Well. So here is for the first spectrum. Now I go to a spectrum obtained by Christian Brill near the maximum luminosity with an HL at a resolution of 10,000. Yeah. And we have still the flat continuum, not blue continuum. Very, very nice lines of sodium. Very large depths, and is there of calcium, the Balmer lines. But the first thing I see on this spectrum, in fact, after that, is that very strange lines, very, very narrow. And in fact, this is pollution, light pollution. So the first thing to know when you try to work on a spectrum, it is in fact knowing your sky. And I propose that, especially during cloudy nights, you produce spectra of your pollution light.
Pollution.
Yeah. Second point, after we are on the spectrum, what is very interesting is the intensity of the absorptions of sodium. Here is the spectrum obtained by Christian. And here you have very narrow lines. These lines of sodium, of the doublet of sodium, are produced by the interstellar medium. And what is interesting is that from the measure of the equivalent widths of these lines, you can deduce a measure of the interstellar extension. You can use also some diffuse interstellar bands. Here is from the spectrum obtained by Christian, the diffuse interstellar band 6614 angstroms, which can be used to deduce the extension.
Well, this is, I think it was exactly the question asked by Robin in the chat. he mentioned these two lines and said, do we see these lines in our spectra?
Yes.
So I think it perfectly replies the question, your question, Robin.
Excellent. And from the measure of the equivalent widths of this line, we can deduce the interstellar widening of the spectrum and establish that it is about 0.77. And using Python code, I have built from the spectrum obtained from Earth by Christian, I have built the spectrum emitted by the ejecta of the nova, but just when the ejecta enters in the interstellar medium. And we can see that we have a blue continuum at maximum luminosity. So the theory is correct. Playing with the spectra, we see that near the maximum luminosity, we have had during one night, six spectra obtained by Stéphane Charbonnier, Christian Buil, and myself with Eschelle. And we can show in only a few hours a significant variation of the emission and the modest variation of the absorptions. These are very interesting results, of course. In order to find what is the maximum velocity, it is very interesting to build a graph with the profile of the line here in blue and the reversed profile, according, of course, to the velocity zero. And it is easier to define what is the maximum velocity, in fact, of the ejecta. And here we find a similar value for the maximum velocity of the absorption and the maximum velocity of the emission. Yeah. We have had the chance of getting a spectra. Essentially, Olivier got Eschelle spectra during the rise. Christian obtained a very nice spectrum that I have shown before. And there, I would like to show the evolution of some lines. Here is with color code blue, green, and red, the evolution of the spectrum for 3 days during the rise. The blue spectrum, which is equivalent to David Boyle's spectrum, but at higher resolution. We have the emission of helium-1 and its absorption. And here you can see the interstellar sodium lines. And here you have a faint absorption from sodium. The absorption, the absorption of sodium lines appear clearly in the last spectrum obtained at this position. Here you have the fading of helium line. Here we had helium line, so the temperature of the photosphere was about 25,000 degrees. Here, sodium line has gone. The temperature of the photosphere is about 10,000 degrees. Okay. We have a very nice series of H-alpha profiles obtained essentially by Etienne Bertrand, but also by Wobin and Peter Somogyi. And we can see from these two graphs, the second one is a log scale, who allows a better seeing of the evolution of the absorptions. Here are the same profiles. I used several colors in order to show the spectra near the maximum luminosity and after during the evolution of the nova event with the oscillations. And some facts are very interesting, according of course to the continuum, though this is a measure of also equivalent widths. We see that the emission component increases. So I say, according to the level of the continuum, we have various absorption lines. Remember what has been observed by McLaughlin. We have several absorption systems. And 2 points, according to the variations of the luminosity, we can find at different moments from green to red the same emission profile. There is information in that. Last point. Look at, this is the last spectrum obtained just at the beginning of the year. We have in only 2 days a strong development of a component in the wet part of the line. Please do not ask me why. I had this question in my mind. I asked to several professional astronomers why we have this development, and the response is we don't know. This is very important to think that all that is very, very complex. The development of the spectrum of a nova is much more complex than the development of the spectrum of a supernovae. Much more complex due to the physical conditions, the opacity and so on. And we have questions, we have not the answer, but we produce data which will be used in the next years or decades, why not, when specialists will have the tools to understand the spectrum. We are also working for posterity.
Yes, for the long time.
For the long time, yes. Remember that AVSO observers have collected photometric data about SS Cygni since about the mid of the 19th century. Thousands and thousands of data. And only in the 30s, a theory of dwarf nova outburst has been produced from the observations of these volunteers. More than 50 years or 70 years after the first observations by amateurs of AVSO. Next, this is the beginning of the outburst with always the same color code, blue, green, red, and it is interesting to see that the absorption seems to lower. In fact, this is essentially an effect of the increase of the emission. The radial velocity of the absorption at the state is about constant. This one is very, very, very nice. I think I will have to add the name of the observer because this is fantastic. I think it is Etienne Bertrand. This is the H-alpha profile at the beginning of the observation, thus in blue. And there is something, very strange. We have a faint absorption, we have emission, and we have a very strong emission in the wet part of the line. There is no line which can be identified as this wavelength or radial velocity. This can be understood when, with plot spectra, you combine the profiles of H alpha, H beta, H gamma, and you see that the absorption in H alpha line. We have also absorption in H beta, H gamma. We have the emission with about the same profiles, but in H beta and H gamma, we have not this bump. So we can say that this bump is not produced in bulbar lines. What is the answer? This is the second question I have in mind. I have raised the question to several professional observers, astronomers, and they have not the response. So, franchement, c'est pas mal. We have, with the first spectra obtained by Olivier David, helium in the rise of the nova, showing what was the temperature during the rise? We have this, we don't know where we stand. I cannot say more. I will share another, and now it will not be very long, I think, after that. Sorry for the time. J'ai beaucoup de mal avec mes trucs, moi. Just a minute, please. I think I have to close. I have too much soft. What can I close? I have too many windows opened. I would like to share that with you. J'ai l'écran. Ah, good. Here is. So we have used the perspective. It is interesting also to produce it. His own you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes,
this is MATLAB.
With MATLAB, yeah. Yep. So I used essentially Echelle spectra for all the survey of the NOVA, and we can build representations. Here is H alpha line. Here is the radial velocity.
So we see the code, in fact. We don't see the graph.
Hey, encore plus compliqué que ce que je pensais. Voilà. You have the figure?
Yes, this is the graph. This is the 3D graph. Okay.
Cool, cool, cool. So here is, you have the radial velocity in axis, X axis. Y axis is the Julien date. And here, the intensity, relative intensity, according to the continuum. Continuum has been normalized to one at minus 2,500 kilometers. And thus, you obtain the variation of the profile. Or, of course, what we have seen is a very low, very faint emission near the maximum luminosity. Increase of the emission, of course. And here you have, at the beginning of the outburst near maximum luminosity, the pre-maximum absorption. After, you have other systems of absorptions which have been described by McLaughlin, which appear. And the more the NOVA evolves, the higher are the luminosities. Very strange. It is, while the opacity lowers, we see more and more far in the ejecta with theoretically the lower velocities. And when we see more and more far in the ejecta, we have higher and higher velocities. This is counterintuitive.
Mm-hmm. Ouais.
Hein? Something like that. Yes. This is very, very complex. Steve Shaw has a model for which, depending on the opacity, it is this behavior can be understood with a single ejecta. I have, it is very difficult for me to understand because it is a complex, very complex model. I've asked Steve for the information letter to try to describe with plots and so on his idea, and it is not possible. Thus, the first idea of the first ejecta at low velocity, then winds emitted from the envelope, which have an increased velocity when the envelope recedes, is very easier for me to understand. But this is not because it is easier to understand that it is the reality. Now I propose to go to the end of the presentation, perhaps a little bit quickly, because we arrive to 2 hours and 50 minutes, and 30 minutes, yeah. We can build, of course, you see my graph, I think?
Yes.
Other lines, sodium and so on. I come back on a low resolution spectra from the sequence obtained by many observers, Pavel Dubovsky, David Boyd, Woody Sims, and so on, and French observers, and so on. And from that, we can build a sequence of the development of the spectrum. I add, of course, on the final PowerPoint, the list of the observers who contributed to this very nice development of the first, when I build such, such graph, essentially also with David Boyd, for the information letter, when I see this, I say, what happened? And I check the other spectra, and in fact, this is an artifact. So it is very best with removing the spectrum, and there we have the development of the spectrum of the nova, such they are shown in the various publications by Williams and so on. Thus, of course, the Balmer lines. At just the beginning, thanks to David Boyd's spectrum, the helium-1 line. and after the development of the spectrum. So we see all the variations. There, the increase of sodium one lines. Excuse me, what I do? There. Here, the development of some lines, development of ionized line, and so on. Very interesting, very nice. And from that, we can also take the high resolution spectra because we have detected there a sudden increase of sodium lines. And it is very interesting to see in high resolution spectra what happens. So we have always the same color code. Here we see the interstellar lines, and there we see the various components of sodium lines. What is very interesting after is to check also what happened to I1 two lines. And excuse me, one again. I took a single spectrum obtained by Juan Guaroflo, and I build a graph with the various lines of 42 multiplet of I1, the famous three. Excuse me again. This one. And this is very interesting because here we have approximately the continuum. And the problem is that there are so many absorptions that it is very difficult with only one line. Example, the first line of the multiplet near H beta. Are these absorptions produced by I1 or something else? And in fact, if you compare the three lines, you can see that these two absorptions are produced by I1 because the shape is the same for the three lines. Here, you can see that in the blue line, the first line, these two absorptions do not appear in the two other lines. So these absorptions have been produced by another element, another ion. There, the same for the last line of the type triplet, you have a different shape according to the two first lines. And thus, from that, you can say that the shape of the I1 line is about that one. And all the absorptions are produced by other transitions. Nice evolution of the lines from that. And I will finish by, you are not lying, are you tired?
Well, if we look at the number of participants, people are still there.
Good. Yes, because it is afternoon in US. I think that, yes, this is the last part. This is, I think, very interesting. Steve Shaw asked us to produce spectra of the near IR, because in this part of the spectrum, this is shown on this spectrum obtained by Juan Guaro with an HL. I applied a Gaussian filter in order to remove the noise. And we have, in fact, in this part of the spectrum, three lines of neutral oxygen produced by different mechanisms. These lines, are shown on a gottrium diagram of neutral oxygen. We have singlets, triplets, quintets. We have, from the ground state, possibility to observe the so-called forbidden lines, in fact, produced by electron collisions, which are well known by most of the observers, because they produce the auroral line and also the nebular lines, the famous doublet at 600, 300 and 6363. And we have also this line, we see, which is very intense and very important, and this other line, which is also very interesting. You see that they come from different parts, in fact, of the Dwaglia. And in fact, we can compare, I've done that with various spectra. I add, of course, the observers, and one can see that the shapes, of the lines are not the same. So we have access to different parts, in fact, of the ejecta according to the line we are observing. To understand? For the line 8446, it is known, to be produced essentially by resonance, fluorescence, and the coincidence of the wavelengths of Lyman beta line in oxygen, and excitation level of oxygen one, and one can see that the wavelengths are very, very similar. So you have a mechanism of excitation of electrons from the ground state of oxygen one by, in fact, the Lyman beta photons, which are, of course, very numerous in the radiative field, which excites the electron of the ground state to the state with two transitions. This one, unfortunately, is not observed in our spectra, it is out of the range of no of our possibilities, but this one is well observed. So with the observation of this line, of the intensity of the line, of the profile of the line, you have a seeing, in fact, of the UV lines produced in the radiative field of the ejecta. The second line is very interesting also because it is produced by the recombination of ionized atom of oxygen. So the one electron has been removed from the atom, and three electrons recombines, to oxygen one time ionized. So you have an information which is different from information given by this line, because here you are in the field of the ejecta, which is ionized for oxygen, so more than 15,000 degrees. The last one is the famous forbidden line of oxygen. So it happens only in parts of the ejecta which are neutral and with a low density of electron. So the transition. We have different profiles, and we can see a comparison in one spectrum obtained by Juan Guaro, the different shapes of the ejecta. We can also compare these lines with, for instance, H beta. We have seen that O3-7773 has been produced by recombination. So we can compare the profile of this line with H beta line. And we have the same profile. Normally, that's normal because H beta has been produced essentially from recombination of electrons to hydrogen, ionized hydrogen, and they have about the same ionization energy. So this is very correct to have the same shapes. Another comparison, which can be very interesting, is to compare what is called the isoelectronic sequence. It has ions which have the same number of electrons in their external couche électronique. Yeah. Bon. And we see
this layer.
Layer, thank you very much. The profiles are very different. They should be the same. So there is something to study about the difference of the shapes. And from the observations of essentially neutral oxygen one lines, here is the evolution of the line. Steve Shore built a model of the line using the Monte Carlo method and produced a view of the density, essentially density, but also opacity, ionization state of the ejecta using the Monte Carlo method modelized on his conception of single jecta. We have many spectra in the near IR obtained by Paolo Berardi, Umberto Soeccia, Robin Liebetter, which will be used to study the NOVA. We have interesting spectra obtained by Pierre Dubreuil, essentially with the new prototype UVX4, and with the lines in the near UV. And this is very important for the study of novae, but also symbiotic stars. And we are waiting avec beaucoup d'impatience the spectra which will be produced by the new UVX produced by Shediac. I wanted to add the last spectrum, the last spectra obtained by Woody Sims and Pavel Lubowski. Unfortunately, I have a problem of timing. I add them on the presentation. I come back, yes, on very important thing that will be shown is in this slide. I will produce a comparison of spectra obtained by Woody Sims and Pavel Lubowski during the same night, in fact, a few hours of difference with LISA spectrographs, one in Slovakia, the second one in USA. And we have a perfect, very, very perfect consistency of the continua. This is very important. Low resolution spectra are very interesting since they have a very good atmospheric and instrumental correction, and possibly, if possible, that they are flux calibrated. At the end, the database with now 46 NOVA events, about 3,000 spectra. The ongoing work on the new automated database. This is a PhD student who is working on this new tool. Last thing with David and Woody, we are producing a quarterly newsletter. And I thanks a lot all the observers, of course. Hein? This is a list of observers for this NOVA. I thanks a lot Steve Shaw, David, of course, and Woody for the support to the production of the information letter. I have a special thing to Terry, Paul, and Colin, because we have had bright NOVA in the northern skies, but they have many, many NOVA in southern skies, and their participation is very, very important. Acknowledgement to Colin for his spectra of symbiotic NOVA. And thank you to the professional teams which help us use our spectra and I remember them that they have to respect the rules for using the spectra gathered in the spectral database. Thus, what should have been done by ID and all in a Western publication, but has not been done, I do it, and I thank observers Marcon and Napoleão, Boisil, Thierry Bolsen, Juan Garo, and Christian Will for their spectra used in this publication. We hope that we'll be able to maintain an open database. This is our spirit to have to share the results, but professionals must respect our rules. I think it's clear, François.
Yes.
Yay! Thank you very much for your attention, and hoping that COVID will disappear. I hope that we shall have clear skies, novae, supernovae for the next year. Thank you very much for your attention, because it is not easy for me to speak in English.
Thank you very much, François. Thank you very much.